Good morning. Last in the last class we were talking about interference in the thin film. I started the topic actually, not covered completely. So just give you a brief idea again. What is thin film and how interference can be produced in the reflected light and in the transmitted light. Now if you look at the diagram anyway, it's a very thin film. Now when you say a thin film, the thickness should be of the order of 0.5 micrometer to 10 micrometers. So whenever you have a medium which is a layer of a medium which is of this order, then you can consider that thin layer of the a medium, optical medium, as a thin film. Now when you incident some radiation or some here we are talking about light, so when you incident light on this thin film, there is, as you know, that there is always a possibility of reflection and refraction, and there are certain laws which govern the reflection and refraction. So at this point there will be reflection, then the ray enters into the medium and then it is refracted, means it is transmitted basically, so the light will go out of the medium. Now here it's a reflection. Now again at this point anyway, because there is again a change in the medium, here you have a thin layer and again here it is air basically. So at this point also there will be a reflection. So the reflected light goes here, then there will be a reflection and so on. Now the amount of light which is reflected from the thin film, it entirely depends on the value of the refractive index of the medium. So when you say value of the refractive index of the medium, now if I consider here this thin film as a glass plate, then you know the value of the refractive index of the glass is 1.52. This is just an average value because there are variety of glasses available, so they have little variation in their refractive indices. But here we are considering just 1.52, and this is the definition of reflection coefficient, which gives you the information that how much amount of light will be reflected, how much amount of the light will be reflected. So this is mu minus 1, mu plus 1. So when you substitute the value, then u of 10.042 is the reflection coefficient. Now when you say 0.05042 is the reflection coefficient, it means 4.2% of the incident radiation will be reflected and remaining will be transmitted. So you can understand a large portion of the light will be transmitted, will be reflected, some portion will be reflected. Now if you look at the successive reflections, then you consider anyway this first ray is having a 4% reflection, then you have a transmission of remaining 96%. Again here at this point 4% would be reflected and remaining will go as a transmitted ray, so you have 92% transmitted. Similarly, this 4%, which is 4% of 96% is reflected, then again you know 96% of that will be transmitted. So you can see anyway the first and second reflected rays are significant anyway, because if you look at the numbers 4%, 3.65%, then the third one is very very small. So you have two reflected rays which are intense enough anyway, and when these two rays overlap, when there is a superposition of these two rays, what happens? There will be an interference pattern generated. So this is, if you look at these reflected rays and then if you observe them through the telescope or microscope, whatever device you have or whatever arrangement you have, then you see there will be a redistribution of intensity pattern, and that redistribution is considered as an interference pattern due to the reflected light in thin film. Now instead of considering the reflected light, if you consider these transmitted rays, because there are again a successive and these are intense enough anyway, so you can observe the interference pattern in the transmitted light also. Now why we are using this? Because you need coherent sources and you cannot have two independent sources as coherent sources, so you can use a thin film of an optical medium which can be considered as a which can be used to produce the two coherent sources, and these thin films can be used anyway in a variety of ways. So this is how interference can be produced. Now we move on to a particular case now, because you need to, because as you know, when we consider the superposition of two coherent waves, then there will be separate conditions for maxima and minima, because for one location you will find the bright intensity for the another location you will find the dark fringe basically, or zero intensity. So now where this bright and dark fringes will be observed, under what conditions this bright and dark fringes will be observed. So to understand that, what we do here, we do a small analytical work, mathematical work to understand. Because you know, we already know that if the path difference equals to m lambda, then it is a bright, which we have already discussed in detail. And if this is equals to 2m plus 1 lambda by 2, then it is a dark fringe. Okay, so what we do, we first calculate the path difference. So first of all, we will consider interference due to the reflected light. So what we are considering here, this is our incident ray. Now these green lines anywhere, these blue or blue green lines, these are forming your thin film. The thickness of the thin film is T anyway, which is mentioned somewhere, or it is not, I may mark it here. The thickness is T here. Now this is your incident ray. It is reflected at this point B and goes in this direction. It is reflected and the reflected portion is BF. Again there is a reflection and it goes like this. Okay. Now here again at this point there is a reflection, and this reflected light is going following this path, and then there is a reflection. So these two, ray 1 and ray 2, these two behave like coherent sources, and then there is interference between the two. So this interference pattern we will observe, and we will understand that when, under what condition, because you have certain parameters with you, thickness of the film and certain other things anyway, the refractive index of the thin film. So refractive index of, I can mention here. No, it is mentioned here anyway, effective index is mu. So by considering this, we will calculate or we will develop the conditions for the bright fringe and for dark fringe. Okay? So first of all, what we will do, we will calculate the path difference basically. Now path difference between this ray, so what you have here, this one, okay? And there is another ray. Now what is it? This is common portion. Now this is reflected from here, this is going in this direction and then reflected. Okay, now we draw a perpendicular here, this is what it is here. So what you have, this is again a common portion. So if I say, what is the path difference in this case? So path difference here, this is BF plus FD minus BH. Okay. Now if I say optical path difference, optical path, this is just geometrical path difference. And optical path difference would be because BF and FD, that portion goes in the medium mu. So what we write here is mu BF plus FD minus BF. Fine? So this is what we are trying to do here. Now can you calculate the values of these BF, FD and BH? Just try to do that. Calculate BF. Now consider this. What is the value of BF anyway? Can you tell me? Or anyway, you just write the value of cosine of R. Okay? Which is equals to this divided by this. So this is GF divided by BF. So simply you can say BF equals to what you need to do, not very clear, this is what BG and BF here, okay. So you just draw a triangle here, again. Okay. This is what we have, G here, which is 90 degree, and then F here. period, okay? The angle between GF, GF and this is your R. Okay? So cosine of R is GF over BF. Fine? Yes. So BF equals to BF equals to GF over cosine of R, and which is equals to T by cos of R, which is written here anyway. This is what we have calculated. So this is one value. Now we move on to the next. Sorry, I made a mistake here. Which is BF plus FD into mu minus BH. This is what we are trying to calculate. So this value we have already calculated now here. Then we move on to FD. So BF and FD both are same. Why they are same? Because this is angle R and this is angle R. So you know, according to the law of reflection, the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection anyway. So R equals to R here. This is what you have. So this FD and BF are same, which is we have calculated T by cosine of R. Fine. Now we need to calculate BH only. Now BH is this segment. So we calculate this using BH using this triangle. This is your BB, BS, and this is your negative. Okay? So what is the value of BH? Or just calculate the value of, better to say sin I. From this triangle, sin I. Okay? So this is your base, this is here. So this is equals to BH over BT. Now these two triangles are equilateral triangles, so this BD can be written as BH equals to twice of BG. Fine. Now we need a value of, so here we can say BH equals to 2BG sin I. Now what is the value of BG we need to calculate? BG we can calculate using this triangle again. So which will be, calculate the value of 10 R anyway. So consider the triangle again, and it's equal to U. So consider the triangle delta, which is equal to the triangle BGF anyway. BGF in which calculate the value of 10 R. 10 R will be 2G by GF, so which gives you 2G equals to GF 10 R, and this is GF is what? T. So 2G equals to T into 10 R, which is written here. So finally you have all the values here. You can substitute all of them here. So this is BF plus FD is twice T over cos of R into mu minus BH equals to BH, which is equals to 2T 10 R sin A. Now you can solve it. 2T mu over cos of R minus 2T sin, sorry, this would be sin R over cos R into sin I. Now since this is R, now you know mu equals to sin I over sin R, so that gives you sin I equals to mu sin R. So instead of this I can write mu sin R. that becomes 2 mu t cos r into cos square of r, which is 2 mu t cos r. So this is the final value of your delta. Now one important point here, when you look at this point, as you know anyway, whenever there is a reflection, when a ray enters from a rarer to denser medium, there is a phase change pi, which is low anyway. We have discussed this thing in detail. Why it happens? Because this is properties of the two medium. When it is a rare medium and it is a denser medium, then this is always true. So pi phase difference. So when this light is reflected here, there is a change of lambda by t. And this ray, at this point, there is no phase change. So this lambda by 2, we have to consider it. So when I consider this lambda by 2 here, then finally, because this BH we have considered here, so BH should be added by lambda by 2. So finally, you have a value of delta, which is equal to the value which we have calculated, 2 mu t cos r minus lambda by 2. This is the final value of your part difference. Now this value is equal to m lambda, then it is a bright, and if this is equal to 2m plus 1 lambda by 2, then it is a dark fringe. Okay, now this you can bring this lambda by 2 this side and produce the condition for the interference. So as far as part difference is concerned, optical part difference is concerned, this optical part difference is 2 mu t cosine of r minus lambda by 2 for the thin film, for the reflected light. Okay. So now moving to the next is the reflected, in the transmitted light. So we again do the same similar calculation for the whole case. Only the difference would be now we are considering interference in the transmitted light. So you have an incident light here, there is a refraction, the light goes like this, transmitted light. Okay, now this reflected light, this reflected light is transmitted from this point, goes to this point again, there is a reflection and goes like this. Okay, so we are interested in calculating the part difference between the two transmitted rays. Okay, so this is one, this is another, so you are going like this and this is coming like this. Okay, so now if you write the part difference here, delta, can you tell me what is the value of part difference now? Just look at this, this ray travels from this point, incident to this point, ray goes here and reflected. So up to this point it is common, then this ray is going in this direction, BC, CD and coming out, and this is still coming out. So can I write like this, mu BC plus CD. This is in the medium basically, because this is your thin film of refractive index mu. So BC plus CD is traveling in the medium of refractive index mu. So the part difference would be mu into BC plus CD, and then minus BN. So this is what, and BN is in, so this is what the value of your part difference. Now we will calculate these segments separately. First of all, we try to calculate the value of BN. Okay, so when I calculate the value of BN, what I do here, I just calculate the value of sin I and sin r from both these triangles. Okay, so calculate the value of sin I and sin r. Sin I and sin r. Okay, just check. So we calculate the value of sin I. Anyway, I just explain here, sin I from this triangle, so this is your this is 90 degree angle, this is I angle, so we can calculate the value of sin I and we can calculate the value of sin r. So mu equals to sin I by sin r. So when you calculate this, you issue, because when I say sin I, then it is Bm divided by Bd, and sin R is Md divided by Bd. Okay, so if I say sin I is Bm divided by Bd, and sin R is Md divided by Bd, so you have sin I over sin R equals to Bn over Md. Fine, and this is equals to mu according to the law of refraction. Fine, so this is what you have. Bn equals to mu Md, which is written here. Bn equals to mu Md. Fine, we're going to the next. Going to the next now, we calculate the value of BC plus CD. Now BC plus CD, look at the diagram anyway, BC plus CD. Now look at these two triangles, this one and this one. The angle here is R, angle here is R, so these two are equilateral triangles. It means this branch and this branch is equal, this branch and this branch is also equal. So when I say BC plus CD, this BC plus CD can be replaced by PD. So BC plus CD equals to PD. Now I am interested in calculating the value of this PD. Now to calculate the value of PD, we consider this triangle now, and this angle is R. Fine? Okay? Now we will later calculate this first, substitute the value here anyway. So this BC plus CD is substituted as PD, so mu PD minus mu MD, so you have PD minus MD, root can be taken out, PD minus MD, PD minus MD, so you have PM simply, so this is the value PM. Now you have triangles PMB, from this we can calculate the value of PM, okay, which is straightforward now, mu is already there. Now PM can be calculated using, because this is a 90 degree angle and this angle is R. So you can calculate the value of cos R, which gives you this value is 2T, because this is T and this is also 2T, so PB becomes twice of T, so twice T into cos R will be PM. Fine, so this PM would be this multiplied by cosine of R, and this is 2T. So you have a part difference 2 mu t cos r. Now there is no additional phase change in the path, because there is no rarer to denser reflection in this case. So there will be no additional term appearing as lambda by 2. So this is what the part difference for the transmitted line. Now if this part difference is equal to m lambda, then it is a bright fringe. And if this is equal to 2m plus 1 lambda by 2, then it is a dark fringe. So you need to remember that there is a difference when you talk about reflected light, interference in the reflected light, then the part difference is 2 mu t cos r minus lambda by 2, and when you talk about part difference in the transmitted light, then it is 2 mu t cos r. Okay, now we will make use of this in certain situations, and then we will see that how we can understand the interference in some of the experiments. Okay, so to move on to that, now we come to a particular experiment, the setup, which is named as Newton's ring experiment. Now in this Newton's ring experiment, we make use of the thin film interference, basically the concept of interference in the thin film, and this can be used in the reflected light as well as the refracted light, but mostly it is used in the reflected light. Okay, so we use the concept of interference in the thin film due to the reflected light. Okay, now what is the experimental setup? You can understand it very easily here. What we have here in this setup, this is the most important part. You have a plane of convex lens, which is shown in blue here. This is a plane surface, this is a curved surface here, and then you have a very thin plane glass plate. Okay, now there is the surface of this the curved surface of this plano convex lens and this glass plate, they are touching together anyway. And then you can see here this curved surface which appears to be straight anyway, because the radius of curvature of this convex lens is very very large. So you have almost a very straight line here, and you have a straight line here anyway. So you see this is a kind of a wedge shaped thin film, which is air film basically, because when you keep a plain glass plate and a convex lens on the top of that, then you see there is a thin film which is basically a circular thin film which is symmetric anyway around the point. So the two dimensional projection, you see there are two thin films on one side and another side, but actually it is symmetric in a circle. So you have a thin film here. Now what we do here, we keep a glass plate here which is at a 45 degree angle with respect to this arrangement anyway. So 45 degree glass plate, and you have a monochromatic source here. This monochromatic source means it produces light of a single wavelength, and mostly it is used, sodium glass is used here, which has a 5.896 angstrom wavelength light. Now it is passed through a convex lens. Now this convex lens, basically what this convex lens does, because these rays which are coming from a point source, they are basically diverging. So to make them parallel, basically this convex lens is used to make the rays parallel. So this convex lens makes the rays parallel, and these parallel light rays are incident on this 45 degree angle glass plate. Now as you know, there is a change in the medium, so there will be a reflection, there will be a reflection. So the role of this glass plate is just to give you partial reflection, reflection and partial refraction basically. So at this point anyway, the rays goes here, maybe can go there, maybe transmitted and maybe reflected. So we are mainly concentrating on the reflected here. So this light ray anyway is reflected in this direction, this light ray is reflected in this direction. Now what's happening here, we consider these two points as a upper edge of your thin film and lower edge of the thin film. So we don't consider this surface anyway. So just ignore this. The ray is entering anyway by having some sort of reflection here. So we are not considering that here. The light ray goes straight here, and then some portion will be reflected from the upper edge, some portion will be reflected from the lower edge. Okay, and then they will come back in the upper direction again, and then these rays goes straight anyway, because there will be again some reflection and will reach to the microscope anyway. I show you a fine diagram, a little bigger one anyway. Here it is very clear. So you have a plano convex lens here, you have a plain glass plate here, and this is what is happening here anyway. You can understand this is your incident ray, so which is coming straight here. Now here at this point there is a reflection and at this point there is a reflection. So one ray is going in this direction, another ray is coming from the bottom edge of your thin film. This is your thin film. So these two are basically the reflected light rays which are coming from a thin film which is developed by an arrangement of a plano convex lens and a plane glass plate. So there will be an interference and superposition between these two reflected rays, and this can be viewed by a microscope. Okay. So when you see through that, what you observe these kind of a fringes anyway. Now these are the circular fringes. Now why these fringes are circular instead of a straight line anyway? In case of fractal bioprism, you have straight fringes, but here they are circular. Now the reason here is very very clear, because you have plano convex lens which is circular, which has a circular symmetry. So when you look at the air film, basically a plain glass plate and then there is a plano convex lens, so it has a circular symmetry. And if you find out the locus of the points of same thickness air film, then you will find that they form a circle. So basically the fringes will be in a circular form. Now if you look at the pattern anyway, you see that there is a dark spot at the center, then there is a bright fringe, dark fringe. Now if you look at the thickness of these fringes anyway, or the distance between two consecutive jog in two consecutive bright fringes, you see that this thickness is decreasing anyway as you are moving away from the center, or when you go away from the or at a large distance, you will see that the fringes are merging together. You will not be able to distinguish them. Now, why this is happening anyway? And if you look at, if you use a white light instead of monochromatic light, then you know white light has 7 different colors. So because of that, you will see a bright spot there at the center, and then you will see some color fringes, and after that you will see a white illumination at all. Okay, so this is what is happening. Now, how can we prove that there will be a center which is dark and other things anyway? How this thickness of the fringes is decreasing as we are moving away from the center and so on. So for proving that anyway, we use this diagram, which is very very simple anyway, because there is some distortion in the diagram anyway because it is sketch copy, but you can understand, for understanding it is okay anyway. There are some distortion because it is scanned from a book. So you have a plane of convex lens, then there is a plane glass plate, you can understand. Now this is the center of the radius, center of the curvature basically. So your plane of convex lens has one surface which is basically circular anyway. So if you consider the center of that circle, this is suppose M here, which is very very large anyway. So the distance M O is very very large. This radius of curvature is very very large. Now what we are considering here, we are considering this point for the reflection basically. Suppose this point and this point for the reflection. So this is on our focus basically. So reflection of incident light is taking place here, and reflection is taking place here, and we see the interference between the two reflective rays. So this is the thickness of your IR field basically, which is T. Right? Now this point P, this is again the radius of curvature because this is on the circle anyway. So this is capital R. Now if I look at this distance, this NO distance, which is equal to the thickness anyway, and this distance if I consider NM, this is R minus capital R minus T, because this whole distance is capital R, so this is R minus T. Fine? So if I use this triangle anyway now, sorry, this triangle, so this distance is your R minus T, this is capital R, and this is what? Suppose this is your radius of the fringe, because at this location what will be? There will be either a dark fringe or a bright fringe. Okay, so what we are considering, that this is the diameter of your mth fringe anyway. So Rm is the diameter of your mth fringe anyway. So capital R square, which is this branch, equals to this Rm square plus R minus T square. Now when you open this, R square plus T square minus 2RT. Now R square is very very large, T square will become very very small, so we can neglect that. So finally you have R square and R square gets cancelled, and 2RT will remain there, T square is neglected here. So what we see here, Rm square is almost, now what we are seeing here, one more important thing. When you look at the condition for the bright fringe in case of reflected light, now if you remember, our formula says 2 mu t cosine r minus lambda t equals to m lambda for the bright fringe equals to 2m plus 1 lambda by 2 for the dark fringe. Okay, now when I say here, when I consider this, that R equals to 0 degree, or I can say normal incidence means R equals to 0. In that case, this is 2 mu t cosine R will become 1 minus lambda by t equals to m lambda. Now this mu is basically mu equals to 1. Why? Because we are talking about air film here, the medium which we are considering as a thin film is the air film, so mu will be 1. So finally you have 2t minus lambda by t. This mu becomes 1, this t, 2t, this cos r becomes 1, lambda by 2 equals to magenta. This is the condition for the bright fin and this is the condition for the dark fin. Okay? So this is, we will consider as a condition for the bright fringe. Fine? So from this anyway we have, if I bring this to that side, you will have some. Now if I consider the same value here, so this 2t equals to m lambda. Now consider here what we are doing, we are calculating here for the dark fringe. So for the dark fringe we have 2t minus lambda by 2 equals to 2 m plus 1 lambda by 2. Okay? Now when I bring this to that side, this becomes 2t equals to m lambda. Fine? So this 2t is replaced by m lambda. So this is what you have, a result rm squared equals to m lambda r. Means radius of your m dark fringe, because we have considered the condition for the minima here, condition for the dark fringe here. So radius of your m dark fringe would be equals to almost m lambda r. Fine? So this is what radius is for the dark fringe anyway. Now we move on to the calculation of the diameter. Now if I say a diameter, if I consider a diameter is dm, which is twice of rm. So if I say dm square, which will be equals to 4m lambda r. Now when the diameter of the m fringe would be 4m lambda r. Fine? Now if I go for m plus 1, so suppose if I calculate for the first fringe, means m equals to 1, what will happen? d1 square, okay, which is 4 lambda r. d2 square, anyway, just calculate the square root anyway directly. So when you calculate the square root, d1 would be square root of this, d2 would be 4 into 2, m equals to 2 lambda r, then d3 would be, now square is not there, so d3 would be square root of 4 into 3 lambda r. So what you are seeing anyway, there is a common factor of 4 lambda r, there is square root of 2 here, square root of 3 here, square root of 4 here, and so on. So what we see here, that the diameter is changing in such a way that you have a factor of 1 here, you have a factor of square root 2 here, you have a factor of square root of 3 here. It means the diameter, the distance between the thickness of every dark fringe is not same. So it is successively decreasing basically. So the distance, the thickness or the fringes basically are not of equal width. This is what is passing between the fringes. Now if I calculate the same apparatus can be used for the determination of the wavelength. Okay? Now how can we do the experiment? What we do here, we set the whole experiment and we obtain the fringe pattern, and as you know, we have just now proved that dm square is 4m lambda. Okay, now we can write the same equation for, suppose, m plus pth fringe equals to 4m plus p lambda r. Okay, this is not visible here on this side, and that side only. So you have dm square equals to 4m lambda r, dm plus p square equals to 4m plus p lambda r. Okay? Now if I subtract it, dm plus p square minus dm square, this becomes 4m plus p lambda r. This becomes 4 P lambda R. From here I can say lambda equals to T n plus P square minus T n square over 4 P R. Now this is the formula which we can use for the determination of the wavelength using the Newton's ring experiment. Now what you need to do here, this is what? This is diameter of the m plus pth fringe, this is diameter of the nth fringe, and this is the number p, which is the difference between m plus p and m, and this is the radius of curvature of the convex lens, planar convex lens which you are using. Now for this purpose what will you do? In the observation what will you do? You will calculate the diameter of successive fringes basically. So what will you do? You will calculate, you have a fringe pattern, so I show you the fringe pattern. This is the fringe pattern, so you will put your cross wire here, then you will put your cross wire here, you will put your cross wire here, you will put your cross wire here, and move like that, okay? So you will just find out the diameter, one side of the, you will take the observation on one side of the fringe, then you will move to the right side, put your cross wire here, cross your cross wire here, cross wire here, and then take the observations, and then find out the diameter of your first arc, second arc, third arc, fourth arc. Anyway, you can consider the bright fringes also, because we have done this calculation for the dark one. So this is, you will take the observation at every successive dark fringes. So in this way, you will have the values, experimentally measured values of these D1, D2, D3, continue up to some D20 anyway. Now just consider P equals to some value, just for example P equals to 4. So what will you do? This will become your, suppose your m is 1, then this becomes m plus 4. So this is d5 square minus d1 square. So you take d5 square minus d1 square, then d6 square minus d2 square, d7 square minus d3 square, like that. And you find out average value of the difference of this dm plus p square minus dm square, and then put that the average value in the numerator, divide by 4 into value of p which you have considered is 4 into radius of curvature which is known to you. So by substituting all these values you can find out the wavelength of the monochromatic source which you are using for the Newton's ring experiment. So this is how you can use it for the, now suppose if you want to determine the refractive index of the medium, what you do, you keep the whole setup. Whole setup means you keep your this arrangement basically. So you keep a vessel here if you want to determine the refractive index, okay? Then what you do, you keep this setup into a tub, a small glass tub, and fill this with the liquid of mu refractive index. Now what will happen when you do this, the whole set, the thin film which you are considering earlier, this thin film was air thin film, now this thin film will be of your refractive index mu, the liquid which you have filled here. Now when you substitute the liquid, or when you replace this air film with a liquid film, then mu will come into the picture, and then your formula will be modified, because we have considered mu equals to 1 in one of the case. Now your formula would be, instead of that 2 mu d minus lambda by 2 equals to m lambda. This is for your bright fringe, and this would be 2 mu t minus lambda by 2 plus 2, 2 m plus 1 lambda by 2. This is bright, and this is your dark fringe. Okay, now this mu is not equals to 1, so this mu will remain there. So this is 2 mu t equals to m lambda for the dark, because this lambda by 2 will go here, this lambda by 2 and lambda by 2 will become 2 m plus 2 into 2 will get cancelled. This is what you have, 2 mu t equals to m lambda. So what will happen here, this mu will come into the picture, and this mu you can find out using the same set of observations. So what you need to do here, you have to take the observation for. Now if you look at the formula, then your formula will be, dm plus p whole square minus dm square when it is in the liquid.
Goes straight to the
mirror M2. So either the ray go to the mirror M1 or to the mirror M2. If it is reflected from the back surface, it goes to the mirror M1, and if it is transmitted from this back surface, then it goes to the mirror M2 state. Now remember, this mirror M1 is a movable mirror, so there is some arrangement here in this experimental setup. So by moving a screw, you can move the mirror with a very fine distance. Okay, it is sometimes 10⁻⁴ mm. So you can monitor the movement of the mirror M1 with an accuracy of 10⁻⁴ mm. So this is first thing. Now then, suppose if the light ray is transmitted from this glass plate, then it goes like this. There is another glass plate, G2. Now remember, the thickness of this glass plate is identical to the thickness of the glass plate first. Now this is very, very essential here. You cannot have glass plates of two different thicknesses and two different materials. So these two have identical value of the reflective index and identical thickness. Now what happens here? The light ray enters in the glass plate and then transmits it. Again, this is the mirror. Anyway, you know the function of the mirror. It works as a perfect reflector. So the light comes back, again passes to the G1, and then what happens? G2, and then it reaches to the back surface here, and then from this back surface it enters, and then it goes to the mirror state. Okay, mirror M1. So now what we see here, this light ray which is passing through this twice from the glass plate. Okay, if I consider the first ray which is reflected on the first surface, reflected from the polished surface. So this ray is passing through the glass plate G1 twice. Okay, now when a ray passes through a medium, then there will be an optical path difference produced. So what will happen? This is passing through the glass plate twice. Okay, now when you look at this, this ray is just passing through this glass. If this is not there, anyway, if this glass plate is not there, then what will happen? This is only passing through one side. Fine? Because the glass plate G1 comes into the path. Now G2 is not there, so this goes straight here and comes back and then goes to the mirror. So this G2 glass plate is basically known as compensatory glass plate, because this G2 compensates the power difference, because this ray passes through the glass plate of the thickness T twice. So the second also passes through twice of the similar thickness of the same medium. So this basically the role of G2 is a compensatory role here. So G2 is required to make almost equal the power difference. Now when you see through this telescope here, anyway, because this, sorry, when it reaches to that side, it comes back to this telescope, and then you see the fringe pattern there, because these two rays which are reaching to the telescope are coherent light rays, and then there will be an interference produced. Okay, so this interference pattern we can observe through the telescope, and then we can move the mirror M1 by some fine distance, and then see that the pattern, that the fringes are emerging at the center or fringes are merging at the center. So by counting the fringes or by doing some analysis of those fringes, you can find out the wavelength or difference in the wavelength of the light. So we will continue.